Martin Meredith is a historian, a journalist, and a biographer who has written several books on Africa. His latest book is entitled The Fortunes of Africa, and it documents the history of the continent over 5,000 years, a history of wealth, greed, and endeavor. Africa's natural wealth served not to enrich its people, but to impoverish and enslave them. Martin is here with us in studio. Also joining us is Africa Business News commentator Victor Kgomoeswana. He is also the author of Africa is Open for Business. Now, we have spoken to him about this book. It's good to have you both in studio, and welcome.
Morning.
Good. Martin, let's start off with you. What inspires you to write about Africa?
Well, I had a passion, boyhood passion, to explore the Nile. So when I was 21, I went off and explored the Nile. And I carried on from there. Africa, in a sense, has been my working home ever since, for the last 50 years,
really. Yeah. So, I mean, this is certainly not the first book that you've written on Africa. I mean, your books seem to follow a noticeable trend. The state of Africa, a history of the continent since independence, the fate of Africa from the hopes of freedom to the heart of despair, and now the fortunes of Africa. So talk to me about these kind of angles you take.
Well, the state of Africa is contemporary affairs, really, contemporary history. The fortunes of Africa, I go back 5,000 years and look at the various kind of themes of African history that began then. And there are a number of interesting parallels that happened. For example, 2,000 years ago, when the Romans established colonies in North Africa to feed the population of Rome. Now, in Africa, you have a scramble for land. So there are many parallels that go on down the centuries. And that's what this book illuminates.
Yeah. A sense of pessimism throughout the book, though?
No.
Not at all.
Oh, there is pessimism, but the paradox about modern Africa, as it always has been, is that Africa is a continent of enormous wealth and potential. The problem is that it's also the most impoverished continent in the world, and it's the way of which that wealth has been managed, or indeed mismanaged. That's the crux of the problem about modern Africa.
Yeah, let's go over to you, Victor. I mean, do you share the sentiments? You say Africa is open for business, but it's this immense wealth that is being mishandled. What are your views on it?
Well, don't they say too many cooks spoil the broth? If Africa has wealth, but there are too many hands involved, whether it's European, American, Asian, African. So when you have many interests competing for the same pot of resources, that's what you get. And that's why I say it's open for business, because in spite of all that, there are countries that have managed to turn the corner. And I think in the same way that there are many international interests, there can be many international solutions that can be found. And that's what you're beginning to see. Where there are multilateral solutions, you find that there's a more sustainable, shall I say, path that is being charted. So I can never share pessimism, because I know that the only way out of this is to think positive, and that's what I've decided to make my life mission.
Yeah, the countries that you talk about that are real shining flags for the African continent, which ones are they in your opinion?
I would say Ghana, I would say Zambia, I would say Rwanda. It's not that they don't have problems. South Africa. And I mean, but let's stick with those four. If you think about Ghana, stable democracy, they have elections year in, year out. They never have some kind of contestation or violence. Same with Zambia. Namibia is another story, Botswana. So those are examples, and they are all resource rich, which means that it is possible to be rich in resources and still get governance going. But Martin is right. If you don't have management of those resources, you're bound to have problems.
Yeah, indeed. Well, let's have a look at that. I mean, we talk about some of the massive potential that exists here in South Africa. But due to bad leadership, it falls at the wayside. The countries that Victor has mentioned, do you look at them? Do you have opinions on them as well?
Oh, yes. Yeah. This looks at the whole continent, kind of 54 countries as they are now. And it details all the events that have happened in them. The problem about modern Africa is that it is very heavily dependent on commodities. And there has been a boon for the last 10, 15 years in commodity prices, fueled principally by the emergence of China as an economic power. But the dependence on commodity and commodity prices is very pronounced. So if the commodity prices begin to fall, as, for example, the price of oil has now fallen very considerably. That will have a huge impact on the fate of a number of modern African economies.
Yeah, Victor, you want to
add? And that is why we need to beneficiate those resources. The reason we are dependent on commodity prices, we export them raw.
Yeah.
If you were beneficiating, it would never be the... Again, it's the story of Africa. Africans must decide that's what we want and stop exporting raw minerals, and they won't have to depend on global commodity prices.
Yeah. There's quite an interesting sentiment that that you do have, Martin, and basically saying that as much as you're not glossing over the challenges facing the continent, such as infrastructure backlog, sea piracy, etc., you do say that the fortunes of Africa have done nothing but impoverish and enslave its people. Is this a fair assessment of every single country?
Oh, no, and it's not in a sense. That's a kind of summary of the book which I wouldn't really agree with. The problem is that the enormous wealth that Africa has generated, on the whole, has reached a point of where only certain segments of the African populations of different countries benefit from them. The ruling elite benefit far more than anyone else. There is a growing middle class which also benefits. But the number of impoverished people in Africa is growing. Regardless of the fact that, if you like, the economies are growing, the number of, because of the demographic explosion that is going on in Africa, there are 1 billion people in Africa in 2000. By 2050, there will be 2 billion. And no African government, and that includes South Africa, which is a well-managed economy, no African government has the resources to deal with that demographic explosion, providing all that needs state resources of health, education, and infrastructure.
Yeah, Victor, it's 7 o'clock. I should be reading the news already. So it's a sacrilege to let both of you go. But I cannot leave without your views. I know you gave us a bit on South Africa, but the state of South Africa as you see it now, in a nutshell, what's your perception?
South Africa is an exception compared to the rest of Africa. It is a modern industrial state. It has fairly firm democratic foundations. And it really is a question of managing the resources better than they are managed at the moment. But that applies to governments around the world.
Yeah.
Its future, providing, if you like, that the commodity prices remain relatively stable or high, is one of continuing prosperity. The problem that South Africa faces, as much as any other African country faces, is that its population growth probably outstrips the resources of the government to deal with it.
All right, Victor, thank you. Martin, thank you. I wish I had more time. Here's the book. It's been released. It's in bookstores around the country. It's big, it's massive, but it's full of unbelievable content. Martin Meredith and Fortunes of Africa. And of course, Africa is open for business. Victor, we have analyzed your book before, but it's been so lovely having you in studio alongside Martin as well. Let's take a break. We know news is late, but I hope you enjoyed the interview. We'll see you shortly.